All my beautiful and lovely listeners out there, you guys are tuned in to KUCR Riverside 88.3 FM. I'm Helen with Simple Days, and I go on Saturday nights. And today we got another great show, as always. But I have a special guest, and he is the mastermind behind The Man in the Bottle. Will you please introduce yourself?
Hello, I am Corey from The Man in the Bottle. I was trying to match your your cadence there.
You like that, huh? No. But this is Corey. Corey, how are you today?
I'm good. I'm a little tired, but I think I'll survive.
Gloria Gaynor? Was that her song?
I don't know.
No. Okay. Anyways, Corey, again, thank you for stopping by today. I really appreciate it. And I'm excited to just have a few words with you about your music and your band.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I'm excited too.
Well, okay. I'm going to, of course, go with the basics. And I haven't talked to you about your band yet. Mm-hmm. So please tell me, how did you form The Man in the Bottle? How did that all start?
There's actually a lot of history with my band members. We go back, I want to say like 12 years.
Whoa, really?
Yeah, we've been great friends since high school. So at this point, it feels like we're brothers. The three of them, Carlos, James, and Josh, are actual brothers.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it just feels like we're all one family now.
Yeah.
And this project has been, I put out the first song for this project in 2016. December 2016, so it's going on 2 years. Mm-hmm. And then prior to that, we were in a band called The Vast Alps, and we were playing around for, I don't know, 2 years, something like that. And so when that band, when we stopped playing together, I was like, all right, whatever, I'm just going to do my own thing.
Mm-hmm.
I kept, you know, writing and recording music because I just can't stop doing it.
Yeah.
And so I put out a single, and then throughout that year, throughout 2017, I was playing shows and I was playing them by myself, just on drums with a sampler.
Cool,
so it was
cool.
Like, it was fun, but it wasn't the dynamic that I was used to. Mm-hmm. So the guys hit me up and they're like, we're down,
yeah,
you know, we're like, down to help you out with this project. And so I was like, all right, cool. And then we started practicing together, and March 31st was our first show, and it was our big release party where we put out our album and Other Hearsay, and we've just been playing those songs ever since and writing new music all the time.
Yeah, and it sounds great. I'm so excited that you're here. But also, I wanted to just go back. You said in the previous band you were in, was it the Vast Alps?
Mm-hmm.
It was like the same guys, your long lost brothers.
It was two of the guys that I'm playing with now, Carlos and James, and another guy. His name was Chris.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I thought it was like exactly the same guys.
And just, it's like, almost the same band. Yeah, a lot of people, some of our friends tell us, like, why don't you play the Vast Alps stuff? It's all the same band. You might as well just mm-hmm. play those songs. But that's not my style.
Yeah, I'm assuming it's like a different sound too. Yeah. Just different approach.
Yeah, it's totally different project.
Not that I
projects,
know that
yeah.
one, but just assuming over time it must have changed too.
Yeah, that's true.
No, that's really cool then. So you're saying like they kind of basically met halfway when you guys kind of were making music again together, and as opposed to just yourself and your sampler.
Yeah, yeah. The first album that I put out, well, it's the only album we have out, but
mm-hmm.
it was mainly solo project stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so we put that out, but with this next album, it's more collaborative. because now mm-hmm. I got the band with me.
You got the guys.
And I like to feature other people too. Just other artists, some random tracks and stuff. I love that kind of collaboration.
You're open to it.
Yeah.
I know some people aren't.
More than open to it. Like, I welcome it because mm-hmm. I think the artist that really inspired me to do stuff like that is Damon Albarn from mm-hmm. Gorillaz.
Ooh,
and how he always features, you know, different rappers and different singers and stuff. And
recently,
I just feel like it gives it a cool sort of communal energy. And I feel like when you collaborate with other people, they bring stuff that you wouldn't think of.
Mm-hmm.
And so it almost kind of makes me part of the audience too.
Yeah. Because
I'm, you know, experiencing it from the outside. But
mm-hmm. Get like extra creative juices flowing mm-hmm. in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's always funny, like, I think when you see certain artists work together that you probably wouldn't think they would work together, mm-hmm. and they come up with cool stuff, that's always nice. Because then you see, like, another side of that artist, you're like, whoa, that's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
So that's nice that you're open to it. I don't know, I know there's some artists that are not. But anyways.
Interesting.
Yeah, when one person you had featured is Kevin Martin, I see, and the Tomorrow Comes Already.
Yeah.
Yeah? How did that come about?
I've known Kevin, we've been friends, I want to say, for like 5 years.
Oh, wow. So you guys homies.
Yeah, since Brainstory started working on their first EP, at that point, they didn't have any recording. So I reached out to him and I was mm-hmm. like, you guys are the homies. You know, I met Kevin at RCC.
Oh, nice.
We grew up in the same area. We grew up in Rialto. So I knew him. Like, I would see him around.
That's
you know?
Funny.
It was always, like, friends of friends sort of thing. And we always skated at the same skate park and stuff mm-hmm. ever since we were, like, 12. But I really got to know him when we were going to RCC. And I told him, hey, you know, if you guys need a recording, I'm down to help. Because I know you guys are super talented.
Mm-hmm.
And so from there, we started working on A Natural Phantasm. And... yeah, and then I was just like, yeah, these are people that I want to keep in the circle, you know, keep in the loop and play with and collaborate with. So I hit up Kevin and he was down to do a little tasty solo on that track.
That's dope. Mm-hmm. And then so aside, of course, from just all your music, you do like record other people's stuff,
mm-hmm.
like are you engineer and stuff?
Yeah.
Did you go to school for that too? Or
I did. I went to Citrus in Glendora.
Oh, I just recently heard of that. I didn't know that was like a really cool music place.
It's a weird little gem. It's a community college, so you wouldn't expect.
Oh, community colleges are cool.
Yeah, I mean,
RCC.
You would not expect to see the studio that they have.
Yeah.
At a community college, it's insane. It's an
next
insane
level.
Studio, and the music program there is amazing too. So, you know, I learned a lot of great recording stuff there, mm-hmm. but I also got to network with a lot of great musicians, which
great.
Was cool.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it started out because I just needed to record my own stuff, and I didn't have money to rent out studios.
Oh, so you went to school?
Yeah,
so that's smart.
I do it myself, so
yeah.
And it gives me more creative control over the entire project too.
I'm not afraid to die. fighting for territory in a fishbowl that can't support them all. A war fought with thought ammunition.
So, like, going into that school, you're just, like, I don't know, you went in as an engineer, a singer.
I was a musician and a songwriter before I considered myself, like, a record producer.
Oh, I guess that's when you kind of advanced to that level.
Yeah, that was a skill that I took on to help my own music creation.
Oh, yeah. Damn, so I guess music has always really been a passion of yours. What would you say is, like, one of your earliest, like, memories of, like, whoa, music is my passion. This is it right here. Like, random.
I think I was too young to even realize, to even know what a passion was.
Okay.
For me, it was just like, deep. I'm just doing whatever's fun.
Yeah.
And so I had this, my brother, I should say, had this Casio keyboard that would teach you how to play, like, certain classical songs.
Okay, cool,
and
cool.
It, like, yeah, it had a little screen and it lit up the keys.
Oh, yeah, you like
kind
of follow along with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, and so I kind of learned from that, and I learned a lot of, I don't know, I think I've always had a natural ear for music. I wasn't ever classically trained, but it made sense to me playing piano. And then from there, my brother bought a drum kit and I played his drum kit. So I never actually owned instruments as a kid. It was just,
hand-me-downs.
Yeah, I just like stole them from my brothers.
I'm sure they're happy to share.
Yeah, and I never stopped and just kept going, and here I am.
Yeah, made it. KUCR, right here. No, that's so cool. So your first instrument was the piano or keys?
Yes.
Keyboard?
Mm-hmm.
And then you advanced to the drums.
Yeah.
What other musical instruments do you know? Or those?
I also play guitar and bass, melodica, which is like, it's just like playing keys. It's same concept. You just blow into it.
No, that's so cool.
Yeah, I think that's it.
I mean, that's it? That's a lot. That's it.
I mean, I want to learn how to play trumpet and violin.
I always wanted to learn the trumpet. Violin, I feel like, is so difficult. Even though you can see what you're, like, pressing down on, I don't know. It's grasped my mind on that one. I tried. But trumpet, that sounds cool.
Yeah.
I'm always open for that one. And, yeah, that's really cool. You play just, like, pretty much everything except the trumpet.
Yeah. Yeah, I have to hit up other people for that.
No, and then in your band, it consists of, you said, a drummer. You're playing the drums in that one, the Man in the Bottle?
Yes, I play drums and sing.
And then you have a bass and the guitars, and then another
member who plays percussion and melodica.
Ah, yeah. Nice. Mm-hmm. Alrighty. And for the Man in the Bottle, you guys have any upcoming shows? I actually haven't seen you perform live. I would really like to.
Yeah, we don't have a lot of things lined up right now. We're going to throw a big party either November 2nd or 3rd. That weekend, we're going to throw a big party in the Arts District at my buddy's place. He's got this huge office thing.
Fancy.
Place that his work is letting him stay there. And they're going to tear down that building. So he was like, let's just throw a big party.
Well, that sounds nice.
And, you know, one last hurrah for that place. Mm-hmm. But that's what we got lined up. And we might have another show with Kiki.
Hey.
With Kiki Diago in, I think, November.
Also in November? Oh, yeah, that's
also
coming up.
Also
next
in
month.
LA. Yeah.
Nice.
But I don't know if they have that locked in.
It's still in the work. So we'll stay tuned for upcoming shows.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
Burning away, and you're listening. Oh, what will it say?
I feel like every time you do see a band performing live, like, you just have a more higher appreciation for them. Because, you know, it's always one thing hearing them, mm-hmm. like, on your computer or whatever. And then seeing them live is like, wow. You catch a lot of other things. And I guess from that, what's one of your favorite things about performing live?
I don't know. It might sound too straightforward, but I just love performing. I love singing. And every live performance is different. We mm-hmm. like to have segments in our musical arrangements where we just kind of flow with it and improv and just we just kind of jam out.
I'm vibing.
I would say those are probably my favorite elements of our live show because that's mm-hmm. when we just, it's in the moment and we don't ever play it the same. And so
it's really raw. Like, yeah. You have to be there, mm-hmm. really.
And also hearing how it translates too, because mm-hmm. A lot of bands, I feel like they start out with their live dynamic. Mm-hmm. They play together and they write the songs together and play it loud in their practice space. And then they record it. I don't do that. I record my stuff first.
Oh, wow.
I don't even finish writing the song until I have stuff tracked already. Uh-huh.
That is a different
Yeah, so it's interesting to see how it translates live. Sometimes it doesn't work. We have to
really?
Like completely rework the song
to where
it works live. But yeah, that's another interesting aspect of live.
Yeah, I guess it's just part of a process then. I guess with that, when you like pretty much are creating a song or a track or whatever, you said you always record it first before like, I guess, showing it to your members.
Not always.
No.
I'll record ideas.
Oh, okay.
And then I'll show it to them. But sometimes we'll just be jamming and come up with a cool riff or melody. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's always different. It's always a different process.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes a song starts on keys. Sometimes it starts with just a beat. Mm-hmm. You know. But
that's cool. And then for the lyrics, are you the sole creator of the lyrics, or are the other band members also like?
I write all of the songs right now
from the last album mm-hmm. and other Hearsay.
Mm-hmm.
That was all your lyrics right there.
Yes.
No, that's cool. I really really liked your lyrics. They're like really deep. You mentioned, I saw on your like page that your project is centered around growth, emotional honesty, and questioning everything. I like that questioning everything part because I feel like that really is presented on your album. You have like, whoa, this guy thinks kind of thing. So that's cool. I think that's always good when you hear that, like, I guess, in the music. And now,
thank you. I'm glad you can hear that in the music. Yeah, the album is definitely, a lot of it centers around my experiences with religion and kind of coming out of religion. I don't identify with any religious beliefs anymore, but I was a born-again Christian for mm-hmm. 10 years of my life. I don't know who's going to be listening to this, but it might come as a surprise to them that I don't believe in any of that stuff anymore. I don't believe in religion. I don't believe in God.
Mm-hmm.
I don't judge people who do.
No, yeah.
But, I don't know. I just, this album, I guess, for me, was a chance for me to sort of rediscover my own independent thought,
mm-hmm.
my own individual autonomy, mm-hmm. being able to decide for myself what I think is mm-hmm. right and what's wrong. And I feel like I didn't have that before. So
mm-hmm.
this album was liberating for me.
Yeah, that's great. Since we're on your album, what's one of your your favorite song off of that album?
There are definitely some that I feel like I grew out of. I feel like I wouldn't write those kinds of songs anymore. But
mm-hmm.
the ones that I feel are a little more timeless are the ones that kind of resonate with people the most, which are Sucker Punch and mm-hmm. Tomorrow Comes Already. And I was actually surprised to see that a lot of people like, I forgot the name of my own song.
Which one?
It's, oh my god, how am I like blanking on it? It's because I'm so focused on new stuff.
Yeah.
Like I don't really revisit a lot.
It's, I wrote them down because
Same People in the End.
Okay.
Which is a kind of a slow burn song. It has kind of a
The title says it all right there.
But I guess Now that I'm looking at the track list.
Yeah, you're like, oh, I wrote some cool songs.
I'm proud of these songs.
No, they're great songs.
Dang, that's hard to pick a favorite. I guess it just depends on the day and the mood that I'm in. Yeah. But I think Tomorrow Comes Already is... That one is the one that reflects my optimistic viewpoint. Like I said, it was coming out of a... I feel like it was a dark place. And so that song ending the album almost kind of ends it on a happy note. It ends it on an optimistic note that I'm looking forward to the future and to growing and to changing, because I'm going to change. You know, I'll change my mind all the time. That's what people do. And I think that song has a good message too, because it's about not waiting around to be happy. I think a lot of us do that. We set goals, which is good, and we think, you know, when I get there in 5 years, 10 years, whatever, then I'll feel really happy. I'll feel like, now I made it, you know, now I'm done, which is cool. But I think it's also healthy to find a way to be happy where you are too.
Yeah, like through the process. Yeah, too, you know.
And so that's what that song represents for me a lot. It's not waiting for tomorrow to be happy.
Would you say that's like your favorite one to perform live too?
Yeah. Yeah, we always end on that one.
Yeah.
Because it's got a good energy. Mm-hmm. It's upbeat. It ends the set on a kind of happy note.
be you. Why is it so hard to be right here as you and me?
But you mentioned also you got your mind on all your new music. So you got some new music coming along. What can we hear about that?
Yeah, we're working on another album.
Another album?
Yeah, we have... I mean, that's the cool thing of being able to produce your own stuff is you don't have to wait around for engineers
that's
to...
Really
you know,
cool.
You don't have to wait for that turnover. You can just keep working even as you're putting out your last album.
Mm-hmm.
But we have... Yeah, we're sitting on like... 15 to 20 track ideas.
Yes, a full album.
Yeah.
And then
we
some.
Won't put out that many.
Okay.
But we like to over prepare so that we can cut down on some of the ones that I guess are not, you know, the cream of the crop.
Yeah.
But this album piggybacks off of that feeling from Tomorrow Comes Already.
Oh, that's cool.
So that it has a nice
continuation.
Yeah.
There.
A nice, coherent flow from one album to the next. So it's less about my regaining of independent thought. And this one's more about living in my emotions and being more in tune with my emotions and being honest about them, being honest about who I am as a person and how I think and how I express myself. And it's about having that kind of, I don't know, cultivating that space to where, you know, because it's not just about me feeling that way, but I want people around me to feel like they can be that way too.
Yeah.
Because, I don't know, I think music is best when it's in the context of a community.
Yeah, connecting with others, that's the point, right?
You know, if you're just writing music for yourself and you're the only one listening to it, that's fine. But, I don't know, I think there's something beautiful in that communication, that connection that happens between...
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, between artist and audience, between artist and artist, you know, and between fans and other fans. Like, there's so many beautiful connections that happen there. Mm-hmm. And so, I don't know. I want to do important things with my music, I guess. I don't know how pretentious that sounds, but...
No, it's just basically, I feel like just... You connecting with others with your music, it's, like, perfect. That's, like, the goal there.
Right.
And I feel like you easily feel that connection when you get, like, a response from your music. And, yeah, that's really a cool thing about being an artist is, like, I don't know, it's always risky because, I mean, you're opening yourself up, you know? And then it's always like, well, here you go. Do what you want with it, you know?
Yeah, it's vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely vulnerable, and I think you can sense when an artist isn't completely putting themselves out there.
Oh, yes,
when they have
a
front and it just comes off kind of phony.
Yeah, you can definitely tell.
But when you can sense that an artist is just being themselves and just being 100% real, that's when it's like, I feel like that exists in another realm. It doesn't even have to be music that you like, you know? It doesn't even have to be stuff you normally listen to. But if you can vibe with what they're saying and you can connect with it and you get the sense that they're just being open and honest with you, I feel like that inspires me to be the same way.
Yeah,
you know,
just being real with one another, because I mean, that's how you should be.
Right.
You don't want to be, but yeah, it's really cool when you're being honest in your music, because I know there's a lot of artists that aren't, but it shows in your music. So I'm excited to hear what you have coming up. Do you have a title for the album yet?
The working title, it could change, but the working title we have right now is called Inner Space. Two words.
Space.
It's a play on the phrase outer space,
because
I love sci-fi stuff. I wanted to say another word, but I can't cuss on Casey.
Okay.
But I love sci-fi things.
Yeah.
And
good cover.
But it's also... Yeah, about that inner space, you know, being in touch with
yourself.
Yeah, your emotions and the inner you.
Mm-hmm. Wow, yeah. So definitely more growth coming out from this album. And that's good.
I think so. Yeah.
I know you got the band name from the episode of The Twilight Zone. Can you explain why you chose that, like, episode in particular and not, like, any other one, like Eye of the Beholder or Sounds of Silence? Sounds and Silence.
The shallow answer is that I just like the way it sounded.
Okay. that works. It's okay.
But The Twilight Zone was, it was and is still my favorite show. It's always been one of my favorite shows as a kid. I would record back when we had, you know, VCRs, VHS tapes. Yeah. If you wanted to record something, you popped in a tape, and I would record the marathons that would
air have those.
On 4th of July, New Year's, and I think Christmas, too. I liked the way that sounded. I liked that it had a ring to it. I feel like it's also come to take other meanings for me, too, with that first album, that I had a lot of repressed emotions, a lot of repressed feelings. So I felt like I was really bottling things up.
Yeah.
So I felt like I was like a man in the bottle, as cheesy as that is.
But no. It's honest.
Yeah. I mean, and so it also serves as a reminder to not do that because then
I end up having
anxiety attacks.
Yeah. And,
I don't know. I think I'm in a better place now. And so that title, it keeps having more layers to it for me.
No, that's great.
And I love that episode. It's a great episode, too.
I actually I haven't seen it, but I quickly went to, read the synopsis or whatever. Mm-hmm. And what happens, it's like he finds the bottle and he gets 3 wishes.
Yeah, it's this older couple. They own, I think it's like an antique shop.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
And they have this old, they find this old lamp thing.
Uh-huh.
And they break it on accident. And they're like, oh, great. Like, you know, it paints it like their life kind of sucks. And they're, struggling to pay rent and everything. Uh-huh. And the thing, breaks and there's glass everywhere.
Oh, gosh.
And then this guy appears. And it's a classic, you know, genie in a bottle story. Yeah, and he grants them 3 wishes. And they all end up having a sort of catch, a twist to it.
They usually do.
Yeah, because they wish for, wealth. They wish for power and all these kind of selfish things. And it just comes back to bite them in the butt. And then eventually they use their final wish to just have everything go back to normal.
Yeah. Forget it. Mm-hmm. I'm fine where I was.
Yeah.
Man. No, that was cool. I got to watch the episode. I really do like the Twilight Zone. So that's pretty cool that your name came from, I mean, not your actual name, Corey, but you know, the band name came from the episode of the Twilight Zone. Mm-hmm. So, Corey, we've been talking for a cool minute. Now, I usually like to end my shows by just asking you any final words you would like to say to the fans listening.
I don't know that I have any fans, but...
Oh, God, of course you do.
But thank you for having me. Thank you for... It's been a good conversation. It also kind of helps me to articulate how I feel about my art. Because I don't, you know, you don't always get that opportunity to put it out into words. So thank you for giving me that opportunity to do that.
Well, of course. Well, thank you for stopping by, of course, taking the time out of your busy schedule. And yeah, definitely like to have you come by again, maybe anytime.
Anytime, yeah.
I'll hit you up. Thank you. Thank you so much. I feel like I had a lot more questions to ask you, but we've been talking for a cool minute. So I guess I'll save it for next time. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Corey. And you have a good night.
You too, thanks.
Close at the moment to breathe, it'll take some time. Expect this isn't right. Isn't right. Isn't right. Wait. Not a damn
not today. Someday we'll be gone. But we're here today. A smile is on my face, and on my lips a song. Say your prayers and make your wishes. My mind's on the bigger pieces. While waving after life, and our lungs is the air of paradise.
Thank you.
you need a silver lining. Float on up, I'll show you how. I don't need very much, but having you is a must. What's a boat without a sail? What I have, you can have. That's alright. Oh, wow.